afternoon, everybody. Welcome. My name's Alec McCutcheon. I'm a director of Unicom Seminars. We're delighted to be hosting this webinar today, which is about optimization and risk modeling in financial and business analytics. I'd like to introduce you to our presenter today, who's Professor Gautam Mitra. Gautam is the Managing Director of OptiRisk Systems and also Founder Director of Charisma, based at Brunel University. So without further ado, I'd like to hand over to Gautam.
Oh, thank you, Alec. And we have a 1 hour session ahead of us. I'm delighted that so many of you have joined and looking forward to words of wisdom that I'll be putting out. So our title, as Alec said, is Optimization and Risk Modeling in financial modeling in financial and business analytics. Actually, this is a very condensed version of a 5-day workshop that we do. It's a tour de force in the sense that we'll cover the major topics which are discussed in more detail in this 5-day workshop. And this workshop, incidentally, we have been developing over the last 15 to 20, nearly about 18 years, and has been given regularly in the United Kingdom and also in Germany, Italy, and India, to various business schools and technical schools. Okay, so the idea is that I will keep talking until 55 minutes elapse, sometimes very fast, sometimes slowed down, to share information with all the participants. And at the end, we'll have some questions. Also, after about 15, 20 minutes, I'll have a pause and see if you have questions. You can actually enter it through keyboard. I'll read back the questions and perhaps try to answer some of them. Otherwise, if we don't get any, we'll do right at the end. Okay, so screen isn't going. Page down. 1 minute. I want to share the screen with you. Yeah, 1 minute. Okay. So here is the outline. It's about optimization, what and why. Then optimization, deterministic LP and IP. Our real focus is to move on to what's becoming important today is optimization under uncertainty, that is stochastic programming or SP. Then we have optimum return and minimum risk trade-off, risk aversion. That's the hallmark of optimization under uncertainty. That's how people make decisions. Then actually we, from that point, we move slowly into financial applications that's to do with portfolio planning or optimum resource allocation. But we highlight what's choice under randomness. And then we go to a very special area called indexation, that is market indices, how one makes resource allocation, or rather portfolio allocation, trying to achieve that of the index or beat that goal. And therefore, there's an enhanced indexation. And finally, we point out white papers and research papers. And perhaps it actually gives information about what the contents of the 5-day workshops are. Right. So optimization, what, why, and what, how. I think actually there's a series of few slides where these are mostly qualitative and conceptual, and what we try to do is to put it in focus because the mathematics of it is quite well known. So what do you mean by optimization? It really, aka also known as optimum decision making. It's about making decisions. And what that translates to is having optimization model, a model which captures the decision problem, and some solver by which solve it. Incidentally, before I go to just the mathematics, I'll explain that what is the role of model? actually a very famous mathematician explained, all models are wrong. They can never express a physical problem exactly. But some models are useful. And these models that we are looking at are going to be, in some sense, useful models that people use. Okay, linear programming, very well known. You have an objective function where you maximize CX and subject to a set of restrictions, x equal to b, except to be non-negative, etc. Now, how does it relate to models? Here it goes. What happens? You have a physical problem, and it is described to you to be scheduling or resource allocation, and you have to go through a conceptualization phase. And also at this point, and it will turn up quite repeatedly, one needs to also consider the data by which the model is instantiated. That means by which the data is then taken across to the model. Then we have what is known as the algebraic form of the modeler, and which is the modeling system, and then it translates to computer, the machine-readable thing, and we ultimately create the result, the solution, and then the solution, or having looked at it and found something possibly not so right with the conceptualization, one would move back to, again, revisit conceptualization. So it's a kind of flow diagram or paradigm for doing modeling and putting it to computational solution. Why is it relevant and important? Let's open it up and look at it from a application perspective. Various things happen over the years. Actually, a lot of mathematics or mathematical description was well known. However, things or rather tools evolved. For instance, if the decision maker really wants to get the decision, nothing more. There is domain expert, this is that you can see it on the right. What they want to do is to look at how to capture the decision problem. And then there are specialists who connect it to the solver, tune the solver, etc. And then various development has taken place all through the 90s and early 2000s, where these have been very much streamlined. So looking another way to the left, there is a connection to be made to the data as they arrive, analytic database. Then the algebraic form of modeling, and the tools which go up and down there. And finally, solver level. The reason there has to be expert in solver is because you might do a proof of concept with two or three variable small model. But in order to translate it into the real world with sometimes thousands of variables or millions of variables, you need this what's known as scale up. And it's only some of the modern, very powerful solvers can make it possible, whereby you solve really large instances of decision problems. Okay. And this is also more or less shown in this hierarchy of tools, where there have been mathematical and computational tools have been created for DSS interaction. And you can see at the bottom layer there the information system or database tools, and then followed by optimization modeling tools, and finally solvers at the top. Okay, so why are we interested in these? First of all, we'll talk about some of the leading applications. Now, the leading applications of these are, I've only taken a few, but there will be many, 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 because it's, as you know, that I'm sure as attendees have strong interest in this, that the development of optimization technologies has taken place over sort of late 50s until now. A lot of mathematics hasn't changed, but the computer realizations have changed. And today there is a wide body of professionals around the world who practice and get involved in these sort of models and problems. And we recently concluded an international mathematical programming symposium where it was attended by 2,800 people from all parts of the world in Germany. And many of these topics were very much in each part were discussed and researched and, if you like, results were presented. So coming back to leading applications, we got logistics, manufacturing logistics, retail logistics. There can be different, but all these have been captured in optimization modeling paradigms. Then there is scheduling, transport scheduling, airline, bus, railway scheduling. Then personal scheduling, either in the, those areas or in, you know, health services and so forth. Then scheduling of energy systems and refinery operations. And finally, resource allocation, capital budgeting, project planning, and financial planning. As actually, the last one is going to make our link to the domain of finance in a minute. So one thing I would say that in the early days and the business school representation of these kind of planning models, using spreadsheets, you could solve some of these and people learned how to do it. But one of the biggest drawbacks of the late 80s or early 90s or even, you know, mid 80s, early 90s was that whereas you could show the proof of concept, the scaling up ability wasn't there because you couldn't either model very rapidly because the spreadsheets are good for small examples, cannot scale up, and also couldn't solve very large ones. So now that that took place, the applications have been abundant and people have adopted it. But that has really taken us to the next domain or next phase whereby people started realizing that these optimization problems, the underlying assumptions about parameters are no longer valid in the sense that you cannot make exact forecast of next year's demand, or you cannot make exact forecast of the price of some of the assets that will be in 2 years' time. And hence, although you can write an optimization model, you couldn't really say that that was exactly right. I go back again to my earlier comment about the famous mathematician, actually it's Professor Nelder, who said, all models are wrong, but some models are useful. So we have to now look at how the uncertain parameters can be captured and represented, and that really takes us to the domain of what we call model decision-making under uncertainty, optimum decision-making under uncertainty, or you might call stochastic optimization. Okay, so this part of it, financial, we can talk about decision making under uncertainty, and those uncertain parameters, it so happens mathematicians and statisticians are very good in making models. Indeed, we all humans think by using, you know, creating models and reflecting the physical world. And the created was known as models of randomness or stochastic processes for those uncertain parameters like demand or price of and return of assets and so forth. And so these models which were already existed can also be created or can also be utilized to describe these uncertain parameters. So we'll see now that we move into a paradigm where we not only describe algebraically the optimization problem, the decision problem, but we also have another model by which we capture the stochastic processes and the randomness of the variables by which the models are described. Now, I want to very quickly and briefly go over something about modeling paradigms. There are things known as descriptive model, which describes, like in, as in simulation, what a variable, how a variable or a parameter would behave, and is a server, which predicts how an industrial or social system may behave. Then there's a normative model, which means that using logical structure, we make decision between one or the other. Then there's this concept of prescriptive model, which is it requires an analysis of problems, but using intuition and judgment. An important thing is there is uncertainty analysis and preference or value or utility analysis. The two together makes the basis for making a decision. And the word decision model is used, which is a combination of normative and prescriptive models. But we will use the two terms, descriptive model and decision model. Now, here, yeah, okay, can we, my helper is saying that we are willing to take questions, and if you have written questions, you can, yeah. How many have we got? Okay, so there is one question. So I think it's a good point. Before you jump into the next part, I could also have shown the screen. I would take the question, read it out to all of you, and then move on to the next stage. Okay, what's the question? Okay, you can what? Okay, all right. So when we get the question, I'll read it out, but let me carry on. So here we have got what's called data model, the decision model, which I said, and the descriptive model. So what we tend to do is to, of course, we know the data, which will be connecting to our optimization model. Then the decision model is constructed out of it. And the in order to describe the parameters by which we construct the decision model, we will have what known as scenarios, but we'll come to that slowly. But here is the issue. Most of these decision problems are across time. So what it is, we do, the decision problem we face is known as ex-ante decision. Standing here, we want to make a decision about future, and future is not known, and therefore we have to describe it using some type of descriptive model, doing simulation, whereby we can predict exactly what will be the demand in future or what could be the return or the price of assets in future. But the decision to be made is now. And we'll also show that what's called the ex post evaluation. This is really looking at the role of finding the... Okay, I have got a question here. Sorry, at this point I should... quickly read out. It's pretty obvious. I should have said earlier. Will your slides be available for the participants of the after the presentation? That was the question. And of course, I'm actually will be giving you links to a number of publications, our own as well as those of other people who are leaders in the field. Okay, so let me move on. So. We have here this paradigm of ex-ante decision and wanting to do ex-post evaluation. Indeed, this is something I will not go in much detail, but you will now find it's become a matter of fact. But I'll just deal with it by saying that it's not just making good decisions or optimum and risk-adjusted decisions. But having done that, we also need to do a lot of evaluation of such a decision. It's often known as out-of-sample testing or back-testing. And indeed, in the world of finance, it's no good telling them that we've got a very good portfolio, but they want to be sure that under different conditions, it stands up or it doesn't let you down. So that's what we mean by ex-post evaluation. Now let me move on to stochastic programming. And I will sort of do it in a way where it gives an overview. And because, of course, I can't talk about everything in limited time, but I will highlight the important aspects. So for instance, in our workshop, we cover all this stuff, you know, understanding blah, 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 optimization model uncertainty with the three associated problems, and we'll get into those and tell you that how there are problems which is known as, if you like, expected value or approximating problem, and a two-stage stochastic program with recourse, which can, you know, sort of takes corrective action. And finally, one which is called chance constraint and integrated chance constraint problems, which are ways where you actually say that uncertain parameters are such that you take, instead of making the constraint exact, you may be, say, some kind of probabilistic description of the constraint. Again, all this will are in the, some of the detailed notes which are there, or you refer to textbooks, or you can supply. But what I wanted to point out, that until recently, until about early 2000, people worked mostly, most of the researchers worked in the domain of expected value of random variables. But now it has slowly emerged because we are interested in downside risk. All these mathematics have been taken across and connection made with risk and with downside risk, whereby you are looking at when you, the for the distributions of the return, what happens when there's a bad time, that is the left-hand tail of the distribution. Okay, so I'll move on to thing. You see, as I pointed out there, uncertainty and time plays a major role in decision making. And what people tend to do, and the, indeed the model, one of the models of stochastic program is that of making a good decision now in the face of uncertainty, which as the future unfolds, you will come up with. And so there is this thing called rolling contingency plan or the recourse variable. So at the bottom of this slide, you will see that what we want to do is what's known as a first stage decision. That means some decision to be taken today. And there is a recourse action to be done in future. And that's the way the model is set out. It's called a stochastic program with recourse. And in order to have a proper and full mathematical description, the one we had before said, you know, minimize an objective or maximize objective, subject to constraint A x equal to B, one looks at what's known as, oh God, it's gone on top, sorry, you have been hacking slides before doing that. So what you will see is a omega. Omega is the different realizations of the future values of the parameters, and P omega is the probability of the parameters. So it is simply from a linear program taken to a domain of uncertainty or stochastic random program or stochastic program by looking at many realizations. And so it's the bottom one which is relevant, that is you can take all the parameters and you want to take a look at all their values. Okay. Now, what happens, we make a what's known as a two-stage here and now decision now in stochastic program in first stage, which is shown here. And the realization by using scenarios for all the other parameters are going to be shown there as you have it there. And it's been the first stage here and now decision and W equal to 1 to omega equal to 1 to k for possible future realization, etc., etc. I want to go for, okay, there is a, okay, I've got a question here. Perspective on decision model, as you were, yes. The question is, perspective and decision models, as you are elaborating decision models in the next slide here. Okay, so let me just carry on. And here it shows what's known as the whole range of stochastic programming problems. Stochastic programming problems may be known, given, extend as problems of distribution of the returns subject to restrictions which were satisfied. The recourse problems are, they're all called distribution-based. Problems with chance constraints and problems with integrated chance constraints are other examples of those. And as I said, we have been, our team has been working in this area for the last nearly 15 to 20 years, accumulating both software and some knowledge and training material, which we share and apply. Okay, here is a list of various publications, software tools, which is also taking place in this domain. And it will be the slide, so I don't want to go into any more detail on this. And this is another view that this in decision-making and uncertainty, where you have optimum decision models with constraints and models of randomness or scenarios by which we describe the parameters of the stochastic program. And now this is an interesting slide, and I'll do first three of these. So I told you about here and now problem. That's the problem. That's the decision you take here and now, and you write a mathematical model for it. But you can also have a model called wait and see. For instance, the one at the left on the top are examples of scenarios of different realizations taking place. So if you could imagine, you could wait and see what is the parameter outcome would be, actual demands were, and so forth. Then, of course, you could solve that corresponding problem exactly. And you might ask, what the hell is the use of that? Because we'll never be able to wait and take the decision later. But the use of that is, it acts as a benchmark. It acts as something that you cannot beat, you know. If you were always, with hindsight, took the best decision, you had the best decision. And against that, you can compare what the decision you took. So it has its own value. And the second one to the right is the expected value problem, when all it does is take the average of all the parameters and turns and hands you an LP, which you can solve. Now, the third one is a two-stage stochastic program, which is the most prevalent one, and where you take the decision in the left part of it, the first stage, and the realizations as they take place, for each one of them, you have a corrective action called the recourse actions. And this model is fairly useful. It's been used now extensively to take into consideration of randomness. I wouldn't go much into multi-stage, where you actually see a stochastic process evolving, but and it's unduly complex, and you also cannot do scaling up as well as you can do for first three of them. Okay, now there is an issue. When you do a stochastic process, it comes out as fan, and the ability to turn that into a exact scenario, discrete scenarios, is another mathematical research which people do, and there is some knowledge about it. So that's the connection, that people who do stochastic processes are the stochastic differential equation people, and you can connect them back to those who are doing discrete optimization using discrete mathematics. Okay. I would actually, this is highlighting what the leading problems in finance is today. Valuation or pricing of assets. Now, these are stochastic processes. So there is a tremendous amount of work has taken place. Smart physicists, after their PhD, have come in and applied knowledge of physics in describing these stochastic processes and asset prices. Then that of ex-ante decision-making, as I was telling you, that it's all looking forward, make a decision which would be reasonable or good for the future. And of course, it's not just one's only decision. Actually, what one is really trying to do is to find a way of rebalancing one portfolio or taking these ex-ante decisions in a repeatedly so that as future unfolds, realizations take place of parameters or values, you again reapply the same decision. So that's a decision from there. The timing is also important when to execute, but we don't, you know, not many models tend to do that. This is the main focus of the talk, meaning it is the part of the, we are now putting, getting into the financial analytics part of the talk. And the main point here is people until about 1994 were embraced entirely this business of risk as an uncertainty being characterized by volatility or variance. But in 1994, JP Morgan and all the people, risk metric people, asked the question, what about the downside of it and the downside risk? And that led to definition of value at risk and later on conditional value at risk, that is the expected value of the tail. And a lot of activity, as I explained, it took place, and the regulators are really concerned with the downside risk. And the, what I'm really working up to is, I mean, there is sort of historical perspective we'll give you those, is this, I'm going to scoot to the next few ones, to the following one, is this one. That whereas people were interested in minimizing variance and maximizing return or risk, it was, it is as such fairly useful, but it had its anomaly and paradox. And here is the situation which I set out for you. Suppose we have got two distributions of returns of our portfolio. One is the red portfolio Y, and the other one is portfolio X. Now, if we are not using tail of the distribution, then what would happen, according to Markowitz, you'd, and I'm not saying it's wrong, he had various riders to it and talk about semi-variance, etc. later on. But using straight Markowitz, which people still all the time do, what would happen, you choose the portfolio which is red because it has higher return and lower risk. It is also, if you like, deliberately done that way, which is, you know, less variance. And then the blue one, which has got higher variance and lower return, but it has a larger right-hand tail. And this really outlines the major difficulty within doing risk and return models, where risk is only quantified by variance or volatility. So now I will move on to the domain of how do we make decision under uncertainty, and particularly how do we make a choice between two. Of course, stochastic programming, as I described earlier, is one, but we'll see under the hood there is more detailed way of looking at decision making under uncertainty, and it comes like this. Okay, I will characterize it or explain it using a straight portfolio selection problem. The amount of capital to invest now in assets, decision how much to invest in each asset, and the purpose, the highest return after a specified time. So we are only looking at one time period. Incidentally, stochastic programs are described single period, two period or two stage, and then multi-stage. And single stage is an example of two stage where the recourse variables and, or corrective actions are not taken into consideration. So here we'll have n different scenarios and number of, n assets. We'll have t is a random variable, and all the, if we take all the historical data, they can be taken as scenarios and then therefore used in predicting the future value. Okay, X is that of the weighting of the portfolio onto N, and capital X is a set of feasible portfolios. So the three major problems, the distribution of R1 to Rn, the return, if we write, as you can see below, Rx and Ry as the two portfolio returns, which are given by each of the N assets having their own random returns, weighted by X1 to Xn, the amount that's held in the portfolio, and Y1 to Yn as held in the second portfolio. The major problem becomes, how do we choose between these two? And that is a leading question. And that's the way it can be or should be expressed. That is, we have two random variables, and how do we make a choice between the two random variables? It can be done on the basis of these three. Now, currently, I've sort of set it out here just to explain how the results come out, but I'll go to these three ones. There are essentially three alternative models by which we make a choice. One is called the mean risk model. Second is called the expected utility maximization, we find the next one. And the third one is that of second or stochastic dominance. It's actually not shown here, but it's shown in the next one. Okay, these are, excuse me, the hazards of hacking in the last minute from different lecture notes. But here we go. We have got, in the mean risk model, we can use any risk measure, which could be variance or it could be downside risk, etc. And the idea is that we want to have the Rx is preferred to a random variable Ry if expectation of Rx is greater than equal to that of expectation of Ry, the second portfolio. And the risk in relation to rho Rx is less than Ry with at least one strict inequality. So that's called the mean risk model, and most of Markovitz application are along those lines. Then the second one is known as expected utility maximization, where you have a utility function, and using the utility function, if you say the expected utility of one is greater than the other, and you make a choice that way. And it's anybody will, I'm not going to give a lecture on this, but it's usually concave. The one of desirable one is concave, and you then get into what's known as risk aversion. And the third one is the one which is take us back to the diagram, the Markovitz criticism I produced, and essentially to say that we can only look at two statistics, the mean and the variance, is not enough. Instead, if you can actually compare the entire distribution, then it makes it useful. So what we're saying that to make a choice between X and Y, rather than say that we only look at the expected or expectation of the return and the variance, if we looked at the entire distribution and compared it, then we'll get a better result. And indeed, it has been done by the economists and statisticians, and it's known as second-order stochastic dominance. The first order means one dominates the other. It's too strong a relationship requirement. But second order is such that you are looking at the right-hand side of these two functions, f and g. Okay. Then we'll come to what's known as index tracking model. That means what I'm saying now is that suppose your first portfolio is the index. What happens you have in any area, like it will be FTSE or depending on the country, whichever index you want to choose, or you make a combined index of different country indices or stock indices, and you say that is the benchmark and I want to do better than that. And normally people use the in some kind of minimal absolute deviation fashion, but instead you could also do it using second-order stochastic dominance. So we can do the mean risk model and then apply the minimum absolute deviation, or you could do that means stay close to the index, or you can do a stochastic dominance, which we did, and which is known as, I'll give you some results of another enhanced indexation model for using second-order stochastic dominance. So, by the way, these things also have in practical terms things like threshold constraints, and meaning you can hold buy stocks at a very small, above a very small amount, and so forth. I want to, because I'm not trying to give a sort of lecture or try to pump in all the information about it here, what I would like to do is to explain that what we are really trying to do is, there are slides which explain it, is to look at the tails of this. And indeed, sorry, let me go up there. And indeed, what we are trying to do is to look at the tails of these two particular distributions and say the, you know, the enhanced portfolio that you want is has a better tail behavior than the other one. So, I mean, that's a qualitative way of describing it, if you like. Now, we applied this to these set of models where CVAR was the conditional value at which the tail risk was taken into consideration. And here is the sort of results. You have the light blue, which gives the tracking. The triangle is the index. And by and large, the second order stochastic dominance is always ending up as being equally good, if not better. And this is the same thing with the FTSE 100. The previous one was, I'm not sure. This is the FTSE 100 for a given time period, and it's based on cumulative return. Well, that was the value, and this is the cumulative return. So here, what we have here is the value of the portfolio during this period, and this is the cumulative return on there. Similarly for Nikkei, and then the cumulative return, and similarly for S&P cumulative return, and the cumulative return, and so forth. So I'm going to, at this stage, give some references for just the enhanced indexation part of it. It has been very whirlwind tour, and what I want to do is to also tell you that we are organizing, or rather being, we are IBM's optimization partner, and they're organizing event forum in London, Frankfurt, and Paris of how you can apply, if you like, this optimization, stochastic optimization, and particularly in the context of portfolio to various finance problems. The London event is on 13th, the one in Frankfurt is on 14th, and Paris is on 15th of November. I'll be only talking in one because I haven't got, I'll be away from the country. After that, Dr. Sofian Uzdik, he's the IBM senior scientist, known to us for a long time, working from iLog. He's one of the leading software suppliers. And Nalan, and a part ex-student of mine, she's a professor at Warwick, and David Jessup at UBS. Again, you'll have more details given. And I'm getting more questions here. Okay, perspective and decision models used to produce the graph. This is to understand your slide. Can I have, what is used to, I can't see the text here enough. Yeah, the data we have used here. Yeah, we can send the data. The data was simply taken from closing data, market data, for each one of these indices, stocks in the indices, okay? But we can offline later on talk about that. Okay, now I've done about 45 minutes. I've got questions I can now answer. So can we have questions? I can't see them. Huh? There's no more, okay. All right. Oh, just a good. Jesus Esculante, for assessing risk in supply chains to natural and disaster contexts. Sorry, I can't. Can you? Yeah. Sorry, I want to bring out the question bigger. 1 minute. Oh, that's better. Sorry, you are opening the. In a natural disaster context. Yeah, yeah. So the question is, for assessing risks in supply chains to natural disaster concerns. It's a very interesting and very, sorry? Which statistic tool recommended? Yeah, there is various extreme value tools which deal with extreme values. I mean, natural disasters are really, in some sense, the tail risk. You know, they happen very rarely, but when they happen, they are really disastrous. So we need to know what is the expected value of the tail when natural disasters happen. There are tools, I can talk about it offline later on, but it's a very interesting and relevant question. Indeed, what's happening in the domain of stochastic optimization is it's finding best use when you have been able to characterize the scenarios or the outcomes of the parameters in an effective way. So as one of the key slides that I rushed over was that of having two modeling paradigms come together, one by which you actually represent the distribution or realizations of those uncertain parameters. And these, by the way, in a multivariate setting, that means quite a few of them move together, so what happens, and then have those realizations put into your optimization model in the form of either two-state stochastic program where you want to have take corrective action, or it could be chance constraint programming where still the realization could be looked upon as those alternatives from where you can write a probability of satisfying restrictions and so forth. So I think in the domain of stochastic program. Okay, now I've got another question. Optimal fund managers. What portfolio, can I have the optimization software can be recommended to fund managers? Although that's a very interesting leading question. You see, let's look at it slowly. If it is a question of very large universe of assets, by that I mean 10,000 assets, if it's a global investor of some kind, and indeed we had this, we had developed models and given it to one of the banks, I wouldn't mention who, but who had used it in this, then constructed or helped them construct the model which was given out to many banks or many in fund managers around the world. One of the requirements was that of scalability, meaning it could give reasonable results reasonably quickly from being 10 assets or 100 assets, example, to 10,000 assets. So when you ask for which software, clearly smart solvers like IBM Cplex will be a candidate because it scales up. But it's not always necessary, because if you're, on the other hand, if your asset universe is only 100 like FTSE or 350 or something, you can go ahead or deal with a much more restricted solver, or one which doesn't scale up, but you still need to have features like with which you construct second order stochastic dominance if you're going to use it. So the field is now open and they happen, you know, more is happening. Okay? So what else have we got? Any other questions? Do you suggest optimization models for operational risk? Operational risk by nature is a close to human behavior. How optimization models capture them? Okay, there are two parts. From what I have just explained, for operational risk, the first challenge is to have a model by which you can capture the risk behavior or the behavior of extreme events or hazardous events and how that does take place. And that, incidentally, equates to scenario generation. You know, if you can create those scenarios, then you could, from there, construct the underlying algebraic model. And after constructing the underlying algebraic model, you can then take a decision, and that's where your ex post evaluation comes in. You can then go through out-of-sample simulation of various scenarios created and see how that's standing up. And having a modeling tool which can capture, with which you can do both ex ante modeling, ex ante decision, and ex post evaluation of simulation is the key to it. Because you would need to sort of create the scenarios by doing a descriptive model, fitting a model to the historical data and also some other data that you expect to see, and then using it in the stochastic model. Okay. Now, any other questions? Let's have a look. Okay, that's good. I want to actually, at this stage, also make a comment about another aspect of decision-making under uncertainty, which is, as such, wasn't covered under stochastic optimization, but I could add, and that is robust optimization. You see, there is a concept of uncertainty and risk, which is which says that the uncertainty is come from not knowing how the future will unfold, or put another way, that we cannot make a model of the uncertainty. You see, one aspect of stochastic programming is it says that your future demand, we can fit a model by which we can describe what the future demand would be. And on the basis of that, we make a decision. But there are situations, it's called Knight's uncertainty, famous Professor Knight who had looked at it, said the distribution is not known, it cannot be discovered. So in that case, what one does is look at what's equivalent to worst case analysis, and therefore look at the extreme, only looks at the support or the extreme realizations of the uncertain parameter and maybe its mean, and then take a decision which is robust, the word is robust, in the sense that it can stand up under alternative realizations of this uncertain parameter. And in our modeling tool now, we have also a variation or a version where you can include the robust optimization side by side with stochastic optimization. So, I think this is something that's going to grow, whereby people or the analysts and modelers are going to apply both robust optimization model or stochastic optimization models, and having made the decision, are going to evaluate it against, you know, sort of out of sample expected simulation of expected realizations. Good. I was under tremendous pressure to say that not to overrun. I had attended a webinar last week which overran to leave. Now have actually managed to claw back 5 minutes. We have got 5 minutes time left. I know I have went very, very fast, and some of them were very qualitative. But what I wanted to set out was a broad idea of what are important and relevant in the field. And right at the end, I wanted to highlight, or the last 20 minutes, 15 minutes, that there are alternative ways of making choice between random outcomes. And the one which is, it seems very both rational and useful, is that of stochastic dominance, which is well used, you know, but the computational aspect of it is more challenging than the other two, that of mean risk model and that of utility maximization. Actually, one of the problem with utility maximization is what sort of utility function to use, which are, and that influences the decision. Whereas in second order stochastic dominance, it is more or less overcome by looking at the entire distribution and comparing it. Okay, so I think I haven't got any further questions. Have I got any questions? No? So you are very welcome to send emails to us, to me, and I'll be happy to answer separately any questions. with the slides that are available, and indeed we'll be sending you pointers to publications on the website, and we'll be only too happy to answer more questions. And thank you for attending the webinar. Thank you.